Welcome to the second Sunday in Lent and to the second in our series looking at five movements of Handel's Messiah. Today we're listening to All We, Like Sheep, Have Gone Astray and reflecting on Isaiah 53 verses 1 to 6. I did chuckle when I wrote this in my notes. Do we all like sheep? Oh, there are commas in there.
הפרק הוא ישעיהו נון גימל, נבואה מאוד חשובה על מי המשיח יהיה.
זה וחדל אישים, איש מחובות וידוע חולי, וכמסתר פנים ממנו נבזה ולא חשבנו
הוא. הוא היה בזוי ודחוי על ידי בני אדם, איש שידע כאבים ומחלות, הוא היה כמו אדם שמסתירים ממנו את הפנים, בזוי וחסר ערך בעיניים.
שזה מדבר העניין הזה על המשיח.
אדם ש... כמו שכתוב, בזוי ודחוי על ידי החרבה.
חולויינו הוא נשא ומכאובנו סבלה.
ואנחנו חשבנו הוא נגוע, מוכה אלוהים, מעונה.
אכן, הוא נשא את המחלות שלנו, סבל את הכאבים שלנו, ואנחנו התייחסנו אליו כמו אל חולה במחלה קשה, שאלוהים גרם לו להיות מושפל ומעונה.
הוא לקח את כל הכאב, את כל הסבל ואת כל המחלות עליו. ובכל זאת, אנו דחו אותו.
הוא עשה לנו טוב ובעצם נתנו לו רע בחזרה.
הוא סובל בגללנו, בגלל כל בעצם העבירות שאנחנו עושים, אז הוא סובל את הכאב הזה.
אז קיצר ישימו אותו על דברים שהוא לא עשה, וקיבל על זה. מעניין.
אבל הוא נפצע בגלל הפשעים שלנו, בגלל החטאים שלנו, הוא הושפל, נענש כדי שלנו יהיה שלום, בזכות הפצע שלו נרפאנו. כולנו עבדנו כמו צאן, כל אחד מאיתנו פנה לדרכו, אבל אדוני הטיל את האחריות על החטאים של כולנו.
הבנתי, על פי הפסוקים, כאילו, הוא יספוג את החולי והרוע שלנו, וזה ירפא אותנו, והוא בעצם יהיה בן אדם שנענש, שהוא ייקח על עצמו את כל ה... אוקיי.
כל החטאים וכל הדברים הרעים וכל העונש הכבד, אלוהים כאילו הכניס את זה באדם אחד.
Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Let's think about the music before we think about the Bible. Remember the melismatic word from last week, loads of notes to a single syllable. Handel has had a lot of fun here, notes going round and round and going astray. Listen to the word turn, as the notes turn around a single note, the note G. After the strong opening where the flock seems to be securely together, listen for what are called contrapuntal entries. That's people starting their tune at different times from one another. And I wondered if this represented the flock breaking apart and starting to wander. Sometimes the entries come in very quickly on one another, tumbling over one another. Stretto, if you're enjoying these technical terms. And this gives a sense of hurry and panic. Listen also for snatches of the tune, here and there. Fragmented words rather than whole sentences. If you've ever sung this in a choir or conducted it, you'll know how easy it is for the choir also to go similarly astray. And yet, the music ends reverently and quietly and in contrast to the scurrying polyphonic interweaving lines. Singers sing longer notes and everyone sings the same words with the same rhythm at the very end. They all come together and the music describes a new focus, no longer on the straying sheep, but on the person of the Messiah. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Handel has moved us from the major into the minor mode and created harmonic crunches that resolve. The whole effect stops us in our tracks to contemplate the cross, the whole point of the Messiah's coming at all. I'm following the pattern I've developed over the last few weeks, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, a musician's guide to reading the Bible. Approach, we pray, we read, we capture first impressions and questions. Isaiah, prophet to Judah and statesman over the reign of four kings, writes 700 years before Jesus. So we mustn't rush immediately to imagine he was thinking of Jesus as we're reading his prophecy. When we interpret any of Isaiah as referring to Jesus, we must remember we do so in hindsight. Isaiah wrote four prophetic poems about someone called the Lord's servant, and they're called servant songs. This is the fourth song. It actually starts back in chapter 52, verse 13. By the time we get to the third and fourth songs, we discover one who is anointed and appointed not only to be a light to Israel and a light to the world, the subject of the first two, but also to be humiliated, to suffer and to die. The earliest Christians interpreted Isaiah 53 for us in Acts 8. On his way home, an Ethiopian is reading Isaiah 53. Philip runs alongside his chariot and interprets it for him. This is about Jesus. The Ethiopian opens his heart to faith and is baptized. It's a great challenge to recognize the gospel in the Old Testament. I wonder how Jesus felt when he read Isaiah 53. As we discussed this in a study group, We realize that Isaiah writes his poem in the past tense, not in the future, so it sounds as if something has already happened. But there's no figure that this relates to until Jesus. The psalmist sometimes writes in the past tense too. It's like he's saying, signed, sealed and delivered. Absolutely something will happen. A promise that says, I will do something, holds within it a little frisson of uncertainty. A promise that says, consider it done, sounds much more positive. And so we look at detail. This is where we explore what's caught our attention. This question is still a bit of a puzzle to me. I could be wrong, but I feel that there are strong resonances with God's people, Israel and Judah. The arm of the Lord, that is, his power, had been revealed to them in their historic escape from Egypt, and in the time of Joshua and the judges, and in David's military successes and their prosperity under King Solomon. Yet, in the light of all that they'd seen God do, and all the messengers that God had sent, they had still gone astray. A root out of dry ground is an interesting picture, isn't it? Ironically, the old covenant people of God were unable to save themselves because the culture was too spiritually dry, and yet they'd been sent to the world. So Jesus was sent from God, and yet, ironically again, he's actually one of them. He's a Jew under the old covenant. There are Jews today hearing this chapter for the very first time who are becoming believers in Jesus as their Messiah. Outwardly, there's nothing unusual or majestic about this servant. He isn't even a popular celebrity figure. If he is God's servant, he's not exactly the type of deliverer you expect. But wait, didn't the people of Jesus' day hear him gladly and follow him? Yes, they did, but not all. There was one group of people who did despise and reject Jesus. Surprisingly, they were the religious leaders, some of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, some of the law experts. Nothing about Jesus added up. Apparently he was from Nazareth, not Bethlehem as they expected. He was just a carpenter's son. How could this be the anointed one sent from God? Where is the magnificence, the power, the glory, the splendour, the majesty? After his death, Jesus is still rejected as the Messiah because he died on a cross, or as Peter puts it, on a tree. According to Deuteronomy 21, someone who died like that was under God's curse, not his anointed servant. You can see the logic. Jesus is either under the curse of God or he is under the curse of God on our behalf. And since he is a sinless saviour, there's no question which it is. Peter wrote, Christ also died for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous. Christ is the Greek word for Messiah. Did God deliberately strike down Jesus? Well, I was deeply drawn into verses 4 to 6. Something very intentional seems to be happening. Did God really afflict Jesus? We accounted him struck by God and afflicted, Isaiah wrote. To strike is to lay hands on, violently, to punish, to defeat, to destroy, to smite, to kill. This doesn't sound like God. But this is what got to me. To make both justice for God and freedom for humanity happen, someone had to die. So in heaven, the three members of the Godhead got together and agreed it would be Jesus. This is strong stuff. I can't conceive how the perfectly balanced, loving members of the Godhead could even contemplate, let alone plan for, such violence as the cross. I feel I'm walking on holy ground here, gazing into things I don't understand. This is as intentional as it can get, planning that Jesus should be killed and Jesus submitting to it as part of the plan. Remember how he stepped forward to be arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane? It was a voluntary act. It had been agreed. We're so caught up with the truth that Jesus carries our sorrows, we forget that God experiences his own sorrow at humanity, which is running over the cliff like lemmings or even like straying sheep. I struggle with speakers who portray the crucifixion so graphically. I struggled with Mel Gibson's film, The Passion of the Christ. I thought the flogging would never stop. And yet, I suspect that was a pale reflection of the reality that was the barbaric Roman crucifixion. The startling truth is that this suffering servant has Israel, and by implication from the other servant songs, the whole of humanity, that's you and me, as his raison d'etre. He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. Transgression. We've trampled over God's laws and boundaries. Iniquity is the state of being guilty as charged. So to verse 6, the text that Jennings gave Handel to set to music. To go astray is to be deceived or seduced or to err or wander or be off the path in the wrong. We've gone our own way. Our lifestyle, our direction aren't God's. We've turned everyone to his own way. The sheep are not going astray just because they're shepherdless. There's a compulsion within the human heart for self-will, self-seeking, self-justification and pride. Yeah, watch any two-year-old toddler. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. I'm reminded of the scapegoat in Leviticus 16. As part of the ritual on the annual Day of Atonement, a goat was chosen and driven out of the camp alive after the priest had laid hands on it, confessing over it the sins of the people. The original ceremony took place at the entrance to the Tent of Meeting, the place where God had agreed to meet with Moses. So it was in the presence of God that the goat was chosen, the sin confessed, passed on to the animal and sent away. Now, the goat wasn't killed, so maybe it doesn't relate to Isaiah 53. The image of the scapegoat is never directly applied to Jesus in the New Testament. But let's just note then that Jesus was tried, condemned, and taken outside the city walls. If we remember that Jesus fulfilled every part of the Jewish law and practice, then his death is the fulfilment of another part of Jewish law. John the Baptist pointed to Jesus and said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Another text Charles Jenners chose for Handel. Even though one is a goat and the other is a lamb, the phrase "takes away the sin of the world," for me, takes on two meanings. Jesus takes sin away outside the city, and he erases it by suffering its death penalty, making freedom and forgiveness possible, or in the words of Isaiah, healing. Holman Hunt's painting Strayed Sheep. See the vulnerability of the sheep that stand exposed on the cliff of the coastline, already wandering into trouble. In the foreground, one sheep has strayed further over the edge than the others and appears resignedly caught in thorns, brambles and heavy undergrowth. And several other sheep wander over to follow the entangled sheep's example, perhaps wanting to snack on the leafy foliage. Jesus' perspective on us and our world is this. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Capture your final thought. What has God said to you? And now we're to go back into life with the assurance of sins forgiven. The shepherd has rescued us at great personal cost. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.